Mr. Speaker, the privilege is now mine to offer some remarks on the 2021 National Estimates and Expenditure and the budget speech of my brother, the distinguished Minister of Finance. I wish to offer to him and his staff my deepest felicitations on producing the largest budget ever in the history of our country. I have also had the opportunity to listen to my distinguished colleagues on the other side of the House. And Mr. Speaker, they have a problem. They have a problem which is theirs, created by them, which they have to shoulder. And it is one of credibility. It is one of credibility. The truth of the matter is, no matter what they say, how they say it, nobody in this country who knows them takes them seriously. So we heard the distinguished member, Ms. Kathy Hughes, lecture to us this morning. And guess what the front page of yesterday's newspaper says? Former APNU minister signed off millions in contract to her own company. Kathy Hughes' photograph. Adorn the front page.
Of the honorable member, Kathy Hughes, honorable.
Honorable member, of course. Deeply honorable. Mr. Speaker, we heard from my friend, my learned friend, the honorable Mr. Roysdale Ford. And how can one divorce Mr. Ford from his role during that 5 months period? The Guyanese people are an intelligent people. And they saw Mr. Ford lead that team that sought relentlessly to trample upon our constitution, defeat the will of our people, and steal a government. The whole world saw that, and he lost repeatedly at the courts. We also saw him promise the PNC supporters that he will throw this government out of power by an election petition. And within 3 months of filing of the petition is dismissed. How can anyone take him seriously? And I suppose it is for that reason, Mr. Speaker, that this morning he came here and pretended to be an economist and regale us with some statistics that nobody in this house have ever heard. I never knew we produce so much borer, squash, and pineapples. He told us that our pineapples production, borer production, was greater than rice. Well, two Saijan and same farmers called me, they said they left out. They feel left out because he didn't mention them. Mr. Speaker, this honorable member is highly, highly inexperienced. And he must know that we are intelligent people in this house. He came here with a string of statistics, did not cite a source from where he collected them, and regaled us about sectors that we don't even know exist in this country at that level, telling us that we are planting more cassava and yam than rice and sugar. What shame, Mr. Speaker. And then, Mr. Speaker, he spent a lot of time speaking on a particular transaction on the east coast of Demerara in relation to a initial sale of land to Mr. Eddie Boyer. What he did not say is that that land in question was advertised by public tender and National Hardware applied pursuant to that process and won based upon a tendering public process. That part of the equation he omitted. And Mr. Speaker, I have walked here with all the transactions done by NISIL from 1993 to 2011, and he can read them if he wishes. They are all documented in this document, a publicly available document. It outlines every sale of public lands by NISIL, the process involved, where it was advertised, who bought, and at what price they bought, and even the competitive bids are recorded in this document. So Mr. Ford has no credibility whatsoever to question anybody on this side.
Well, Honorable Attorney General, if you don't want to say Honorable Mr. Ford, you can say Comrade Ford.
Mr. Speaker, The lands that are under review now by this administration, Mr. Speaker, are lands that were gifted away without any known public process whatsoever. That is the difference. And lands that were given not to the ordinary Guyanese, but to cronies on that side. That is why he said that we are witch hunting PNC supporters. It's not PNC supporters. They are friends and cronies of the PNC who benefited from public lands by virtue of private transactions never made public. And those, Mr. Speaker, those transactions we will continue to review, and where possible, we will take the requisite steps to restore those lands to the ownership of the people of this country. Mr. Speaker, 55 years after independence and 51 years after attaining Republican status, our country is now fortuitously poised for an unprecedented economic takeoff, which holds the certain potentiality of not only transforming our country itself, but transforming the lives of our people and indeed future generations in a manner never contemplated before. At this fundamental juncture, Mr. Speaker, Guyanese of every race and class must now make a choice. Will they come on board with our government, or will they continue to be allow themselves to be manipulated, misused, misled, and abused by an incompetent, irrelevant APNU AFC? Mr. Speaker, they come here to lecture to us on democracy and on constitutionality, but they think that the Guyanese people have forgotten that in 1968 they stole their rights to choose a government of their choice. In 1973, they rigged the elections. In 1977, they rigged the referendum. In 1980, they rigged the elections. In 1985, they rigged the elections. How can Guyanese forget that? And you coming to tell us now about democracy? Mr. Speaker, the Honorable Member, my distinguished friend and learned colleague, Mr. Kemraj Ramjetan, spoke about debt and debt management, and tell us that we are borrowing too much. And Mr. Speaker, it is the PNC whose umbrella he shelters under now that made Guyana and Guyanese the most indebted people per capita on planet Earth after 1992. And this gentleman is lecturing to us about debt management, Mr. Speaker. We borrow, but we borrow in a sustainable manner with a proper assessment of our revenue stream to repay. How do you want us to build the country, Mr. Ramjetan, Honorable Member? You want us to throw a box? So we will borrow, but we will borrow in a manner that is prudent, manageable, and we will pay it back, as we have always done. Mr. Speaker, how can the members of this House and members of the public not recall that after 21 years or more in the political wilderness, they got a one-seat majority after the 2011 elections? And rather than use that one-seat majority after so many years in political wilderness to exact and extract more for the people of this country, they use that one-seat majority to slash constitutional agencies' budget, to strike down national transformational projects, and to vote down legislation that sabotaged us internationally, causing us to be blacklisted as a money laundering state. That is what they use their power for. And then in 2015, they assume the government. And after 5 short years, they empty the treasury, skyrocketed the national debt, imposed over 200 new taxes on the backs of the people, crippled the productive sectors, drove fear into the business community with the use of SAR and SOKU, destroyed the reputation of highly qualified Guyanese who worked with the previous government by instituting trumped-up charges, cost 30,000 Guyanese to lose their jobs, including 7,000 sugar workers and 2,000 Amerindian CSO workers, seize lands from rice farmers, repeatedly violate the Constitution, being the first country in the world to refuse to hold an election within the prescribed time after being defeated by a no confidence motion, plunder the treasury and extra budgetary agencies with unauthorized spending, sign the most lopsided oil contract in the history, and swindle 15 million of an 18 million signing bonus, and in the end, shamelessly trying to steal another term in government by attempting to pervert the election results. That is your track record over the last 5 years, and the people of Guyana are very familiar with it. Now in opposition, the honorable members are demonstrating with crystalline clarity to the people of this country that you are too incompetent, too divisive, and too boorish to represent them. The honorable members' behavior in this house has descended to the lowest ebb in our parliamentary history, and they have done it for the world to see. The people have expressed their disgust at the way that you have behaved. And Mr. Speaker, I walked here with the Kaicho News, just one newspaper I picked up randomly, and the letter columns of Friday the 26th, Speaker fails to do his job, Kit Nascimento. Dishonorable members in the House, Dr. Vishnu Bisram. Disappointed with Tabitha Sarabo Halley's presentation, Aditya Bhatt. Parliament shames Guyana, E.B. John. Every single letter in the letter column of last Friday denounced behavior in this House, mostly by your side. Mr. Speaker, Parliament is the highest discussion forum in our constitutional democracy. Members come here not on their own volition to prosecute their own agendas, but they come here to represent the interests of our people. Each of us individually represent the interests of at least 5,000 Guyanese. In the discharge of those responsibilities, we are mandated to carry ourselves with decency and decorum. Mr. Speaker, both in this House as well as in the precincts of this House, the entire compound of this building falls within the precincts of this House. Mr. Speaker, look at this. Look at this, Honorable Member Sherrod Duncan, in the precincts of this National Assembly. This is what he did, and posted on his Facebook page for all to see, lying on the floor with his pants open. And this is what he publishes for the world to see in the precincts of this House. In the precincts of this House. Mr. Speaker, that kind of degenerate vulgarity must be condemned in the strongest possible manner. Mr. Speaker, not having a track record of performance to which honorable members can point, and because of their disgraceful attempt to steal government from March to August, an attempt that has been deprecated by the judiciary, condemned locally and internationally, the honorable members are unable to make a constructive contribution in this National Assembly. So they come here and they hurl personal attacks and invectives, manufacture accomplishments,
honorable
and worse yet.
I will have to get you to withdraw steal, because I see here thief is a non-parliamentary word too.
What, sorry, sir?
Steal, you said. I have to get you to withdraw.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I withdraw. I withdraw, no problem. I hope
Thank
I'm getting
you.
Back my time, Mr. Speaker. The honorable members come here and they pretend to be representatives of Afro-Guyanese when all that they have done in government, Mr. Speaker, whichever epoch you wish to examine, is to pauperize the Guyanese, the working people, including Afro-Guyanese. Mr. Speaker, and at this juncture, we have to speak candidly, because that's why we are here, and that's why we are given immunities. Let me make it abundantly clear, Mr. Speaker, that none of the honorable members on that side of the House is more qualified to represent Afro-Guyanese or any grouping of people more than anybody on this side of the House. And I want to make that very clear, Mr. Speaker. This Afrocentric charade of members on that side must be dismantled. Mr. Speaker, I've heard them look at our Honorable Prime Minister, Mark Phillips, with substantive responsibilities, and they label him a mere token. How disrespectful. Where do they get that authority from? To look at the Honorable Member, you, Todd, who is responsible for the foreign relations of our country, and label him a mere token. How can you look at the Honorable Miss Onage Waldron, responsible for industry and commerce and tourism in this country, and label her a mere token? How can you look at the Honorable Member Joe Hamilton, who's responsible for labor relations in our country, and label him a mere token? How can you look at Mr. Ben, the Honorable Member, responsible for our national security, and label him a mere token? Look at Mr. Kwame McCoy, responsible for the entire state media, and you label him a token? Mr. Speaker, this kind of discrimination must stop. And Mr. Ajil, responsible for public infrastructure, perhaps the most important portfolio, and you label him a token. How dare you, Mr. Speaker? This confounded nonsense must stop. It must stop, Mr. Speaker. And Mr. Speaker, let me examine a few instances in their government to show the duplicity. One of the first things that they did when they got into government, Mr. Speaker, was to accept a letter written by a lawyer on behalf of BK International, and rather than sue that company for breach of a contract at Hagbosch, they paid that company $5.7 million. Mr. Speaker, let them point to me which Afro community they spent $5.7 million in one project. Mr. Speaker, a wharf, rather than repossess that wharf for breach of contract, they have gifted it for $20 million to BK Marine. That wharf is valued $8 billion. Show me, show an African community that you have spent $8 million on. $8 billion. So don't come here to pretend to represent Afro-Guyanese. Mr. Speaker, I see they're pretending to represent teachers and public servants. When the teachers and the public servants strike under their government, this is what their minister had to say. Minister Keith Scott, striking teachers are selfish and uncaring. This is what Keith Scott said. Mr. Speaker, when the Amerindians ask for more land, this is what Keith Scott says. Dismisses Amerindian land concerns as greed. This is your record, and you come here to represent people. Mr. Speaker, and the story of the Afro-Guyanese rice farmers of West Coast Borbis tells it all. Mr. Speaker, the Donald Ramatar administration distributed 50-year leases for 10 acres rice land to the people of West Coast Borbis. The first thing that they did when they got into government, one of their first acts, was to instruct the MMA to revoke all those leases and to give it to their cronies. The MMA did that, and I took the matter to the court on behalf of the PPP. All those people, I have no doubt, they are from Seafield Village, they are from Number 40 Village. They may have voted for APNU-AFC at the 2015 elections, and their lands are being taken away. And Mr. Speaker, I won the first battle in the court because I was able to establish that MMA can't take lands that have been issued by the president under lease. And rather than accept the ruling of the court and leave the farmers in peace, you know what they did, Mr. Speaker? Those farmers, they took seed paddy in advance from the millers. They took gas, diesel, they took fertilizer. Some of them borrowed money. When those lands were being taken away from them, 51 Afro-Guyanese families would have been put on the breadline. They went to court, they get a court order, and the judge said that only the president can revoke. And you know what the president did? Mr. Speaker, I have it here. In Kaiser News, they published all the names of the farmers. And they said this: notice is hereby given that His Excellency, President of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, has cancelled all state leases as described in the schedule. 45 Afro-Guyanese farmers. And today you come here to pretend to represent Afro-Guyanese.
Honorable Minister, as you make all those quotes and those documents, you'll have to lay them, so don't throw them in the garbage.
No, they're here, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Honorable Member, Mr. Ford, spoke about the lands and surveys issue and about the lands that we are going after. I want to ask him, and I also want to ask those on that side, to point to any Afro-Guyanese village that they have given lands to. Point to the people of Denhamstel. Point to the people of Buxton. Point to the people of Golden Grove, the Bacalis, Victoria, Litchfield, Belladrum. What lands have you given them? But your cronies in Georgetown have gotten thousands of acres of riverside properties and prime commercial properties in Georgetown because they finance your campaign. So don't come here to pretend to represent ordinary people, Mr. Speaker. Yes, finance their personal lives too. I have the evidence, Mr. Speaker. They come here and they speak about the public servants. Mr. Speaker, their own Ms. Simona Brooms instructed the Public Service Commission, don't promote public servants. And Sarabo, Ms. the Honorable Member Sarabo, I have another one of these beautiful pictures where she dismissed the Honorable Member. She felt she had a power to dismiss public servants. Public servants she dismissed, and the president had to reinstate them by a commission. Mr. Speaker, they speak about bauxite workers. They're quoting liberally from Mr. Lincoln Lewis. This is what Lincoln Lewis said about them and bauxite workers. Bauxite workers feel abandoned by government, says trade union leader. I have it all here. All of this are in the records, Mr. Speaker, and they come here to pretend to represent public officers. And Mr. Speaker, the best one I kept for last, the Honorable Coretta MacDonald. She came here and spoke glowingly for teachers. And Mr. Speaker, this is what she said, September the 4th, 2018, Guyana Times. Look at here, Mr. Speaker, our beautiful photograph. I love her hairstyle. I love her hairstyle. Teachers got more under the PPP government, says GTU president. This is what she said. And Mr. Speaker, let me quote from her. The Honorable Member is quite articulate. If we look at what transpired under the PPP government when they were in power and what is transpiring now, remember we didn't want the 5%. We made noise about it, but with the 5%, we got a whole lot of non-salary benefits, she said loudly, to applause from the large gathering of teachers. She continued, for the first time in the history of this country, our teachers were able to get clothing allowance, duty-free concessions, and allowance for additional qualifications. Mr. Speaker, we still have space for her on this side. At least I think her mind is in the right direction, Mr. Speaker. So, Mr. Speaker, I believe that I have given sufficient examples to dismantle their mantra about representing poor people and working people of this country, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, in fact, because of their performance, if they are to go to elections tomorrow, Mr. Speaker, if they are going to go to elections tomorrow, they will lose a minimum of 10 seats. They will lose a minimum of 10 seats. Mr. Speaker, as have been repeatedly stated, this budget represents one-fifth of our developmental plan to transform Guyana. As we have said repeatedly, this budget lays the foundation upon which the edifice of modern Guyana will be constructed. My colleagues have done an exemplary job in outlining in their presentations the various projects contained in the budget. There is no need for me to repeat them. Mr. Speaker, of equal importance to what are in the budget is what are not in the budget. The budget creates an environment that is conducive. For example, Mr. Speaker, the budget provides for the creation, the construction of a hospitality training institute that will train 2,000 Guyanese per year, that is to create a regiment of staff who would service our hotel industry. Mr. Speaker, a Sheraton, a Delta Marriott, a Sure Stay, a Best Western, a Hyatt Tower, a Radisson, a Hilton, and a mammoth 1,000-room hotel with elevated car park are just some of the major hotels that are coming here. These projects will bring to Guyana millions of US dollars in direct foreign investment and will create jobs for thousands. Mr. Speaker, none of these budgets are in the hotel, are in the budget. Similarly, the gas to shore project will result in a reduction in cost of electricity by 50%, which will awake Guyana's sleeping giant, the agro manufacturing sector. The construction of a deepwater harbor at the mouth of Barbies River, the Del Conte Highway from Parika to Bartika, the new highway from Parika to Demerara Harbor Bridge, the Letham to Linden, the Ogle to Diamond Road Link, the Mandel Avenue to Echo Bypass will cumulatively make available tens of thousands of acres of prime land for development opportunities while stimulating commerce and trade in a manner never seen before. These projects will be financed by loans, but now backed by an economy that will be in receipt of an unprecedented revenue flow from oil production. No doubt, Mr. Speaker, over the next 5 years, Guyana will be charting its course to becoming the leading investment destination in the Western Hemisphere. Mr. Speaker, it is in this environment developmental equation that the Legal Affairs Ministry will have to play a crucial role. Our major focus will be the creation of a modern legal infrastructure that will regulate these new and emerging sectors, while at the same time revamp our archaic laws to complete a new and modern legal framework for Guyana. So every conceivable area of economic activity will be targeted for legal reforms. An international consultant will be retained to draft a compendium of legislation for the oil and gas sector. In the housing and hospitality sector, we will have a whole new regime of legislation dealing with zoning, urban planning, condominiums, townhouses. In the health sector, we have identified approximately 25 pieces of legislation we will work on, including new Public Health Act, a new Mental Health Act, organ transplant legislation, a new Food and Drug Act, and many more. In the agri sector, we will be enacting a food safety bill and a food security act and other pieces of legislation that will ready Guyana to export agricultural products. Mr. Speaker, in addition to the higher purchase bill, which is in the select committee, we have an anti-dumping bill, a movable property security bill, and an e-transaction bill, which are currently in draft. This latter bill is to prepare the public sector to engage in e-transactions for payment to be made for government services by means other than cash and check. At the level of the local government, the Solid Waste Management Bill will soon be completed and public consultations will be held in relation thereto. From a defense point of view, in order to strengthen our ability to protect our borders, a bill is being drafted for the establishment of a border patrol unit, which will supplement the Guyana Police Force and the Guyana Defense Force in securing and protecting our borders. Mr. Speaker, similarly, in the legal sector, a raft of legislation will be promulgated, including a new arbitration bill, a new juvenile justice bill, a bail bill, sentencing guidelines, and of course, a slew of amendments will be done to our election laws to make the electoral process more credible and transparent, and to hold the staff of the Guyana Elections Commission to a higher standard of care. Mr. Speaker, the Constitutional Reform Committee of the National Assembly will begin its work, and that committee will remain the main vehicle by which these reforms will be driven. This year we'll also see the beginning of the program that will install holders of a Bachelor of Laws degree into the state prosecutorial program. These persons will work with police prosecutors in our magistrates court right across the length and breadth of Guyana. Significantly, the Legal Affairs Ministry will be reviewing the Procurement Act, not only to strengthen the public procurement process, but to create a more level playing field in order to accommodate small contractors. Within a few months, the Judicial Service Commission will be up and running. The Committee of Appointments have already provided their nominees. We are also working on a new and modern public service rules, which will further protect the interests of public servants. As we continue to modernize the public sector architecture, massive reforms are taking place at the deeds and commercial and land registry, where documents are being digitized and the requisite platforms are being built to facilitate e-transactions, including e-payments. This year, we'll also see the appointment of the Law Reform Commission, whose first task will be to revise the current laws of Guyana and to produce a new consolidated volume of those laws. We are also working with the Director of Public Prosecution, the Police Force, the Guyana Prison Service, and the Judiciary to create a joint management information system to better and more effectively manage criminal litigation. The DPP office is earmarked for physical expansion, and hopefully we will get budget for a new building, as the DPP office requires serious physical as well as human resource expansion. New Magistrates Court building with living quarters and supporting facilities will be constructed at Port Kaituma, Mabaruma, Vigilance, and the Lower East Bank Demerara. Mr. Speaker, a total of $4.6 billion has been allocated for the legal and justice sector. We have already expended over $1 million in the construction, installation, and functioning of 32 containerized virtual courtrooms located at Lusignan, Mazaruni, Timiri, and New Amsterdam, whereby prisoners who are in custody at these prison centers can have their cases heard in these courts, obviating the need to transport them across the country to various locations.
And you need more time, Honorable Attorney General.
Mr. Speaker, with your permission, 5 minutes for Honorable Member.
Thank you, Honorable Prime Minister, Honorable Attorney General.
Thank you, Mr.
You
Speaker.
May continue to conclude.
Not only protecting the prisoners, magistrates, and court personnel from unnecessary exposure in this COVID-19 pandemic, but at the same time, it saves millions of dollars of taxpayers' dollars, which would have had to have been spent in transporting these prisoners to various courtrooms, including in the far-flung areas. This year, we'll also see the completion of massive physical expansion to the main building of the Ministry of Legal Affairs, which will create much-needed space to accommodate more personnel who are required to meet the expanding role of the Attorney General Chambers in the coming years. The Attorney General Office will continue its review of state land giveaway under the previous administration, and where necessary, will take the requisite steps to restore these lands to the ownership of the state. Mr. Speaker, the Attorney General Office will continue to vigilantly monitor the performance of contractors executing government contracts to ensure that these contracts are satisfactorily performed and completed within the scheduled time. Mr. Speaker, this budget represents one installment of a 5-year program which we took to the people during the elections campaign of March 2020. By their ballots, the people have endorsed our plan, and by extension, they have endorsed this budget. Significantly, this budget has also received the endorsement of very important stakeholder organizations in the developmental agenda of this country, including the Private Sector Commission, the Guyana Manufacturing Association, the Georgetown Chamber of Commerce, the Barbies and the Corentine Chamber of Commerce, the largest union, trade union movement in Guyana, FITUG, and the American Chamber of Commerce, and all the political parties in Guyana. So, Mr. Speaker, if the 31 harbingers of doom in this house do not support it, the people and the country will lose nothing. The ship of Guyana will sail without them, and they will continue to be an irrelevant, incompetent bunch. Mr. Speaker, with those few remarks, I commend this budget to this Honorable House. I thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.